And we'd like to thank Vita Brevis Clothing for their sponsorship of this episode of Seat Time. Hey everybody, welcome to the fourth episode of Seat Time. I'm Brian Pierce.
And I'm Jason Schmidt. If you watched our show at all, seen us at the races, or just checked out the site, you know that we don't take things terribly seriously. Unfortunately, this last week at the WORCS race in practice and out in California, Nathan Woods passed. Obviously a very serious thing. He brought a lot to the sport, brought a lot to the table. Great family man. In that regard, we always title our shows based off of something stupid one of the two of us have said in the course of recording the show. This go-around, we'd definitely like to just try to pay our respects and honor his memory by titling the show in his honor.
Yeah, we're going to go ahead and title it In Memory of Nathan Woods. Just, there's really nothing to make of it, just exactly what it says. And it goes, a great guy, as he said. So that's pretty much what we're going to title it. That is what we're going to title it. Moving from the, what happened this weekend with Nathan Woods onto what happened actually at the WORCS event, it was nice to see that they, he crashed and passed away on Friday. It was nice to see that they took the Saturday race off the plate and turned it into a memorial ride for Nathan Woods, which is great to see, not just for the series, I think, but for his family as well. They had a little bit of time to kind of see into everything that was going on, and how much the community really enjoyed him being a part of it, which was awesome to see. As everything moved into Sunday for the WORCS event over in Taft, California, Caselli actually walked away with the first place. He got the whole shot right out of the gate, and he pretty much went straight to the checkered flag with it. From watching the videos, it really doesn't seem like he had much competition.
It's between that and his showing at the Hare and the Hound. He sounds like he is
a
monster this
year.
Yeah,
it sounds like Caselli's really been working the system, and figuring out, how he needs to be in tune with the universe, because after last weekend's, unfortunate running out of gas and having to push the bike a mile, he was ready for a win, I think, at that point.
Yeah.
So it sounds like he rode great. The video, the little bit of video that we've seen and all the press releases that have come out with race reports and such, traction was amazing. WORCS did a great job laying out the course, which is always good when the promoters, put not only, make sure that you have fun, but put on a really good race. But everybody had fun. So first place, Kurt Caselli. Second place actually went to Kyle Summers with the VMS Yamaha team. And third place was very hard fought, but Bobby Garrison walked away with third place. So congrats, guys, you all. From everything we've read and hopefully what we'll see soon, you guys have done a really, really good job. I'm really proud of you. All right. So next is on to the TSCEC stuff. We kind of did our own junk this weekend and together.
Yes.
Bloody wasn't out drinking while I was racing. We actually did this. We drank and rode together.
I actually have a motorcycle. It's amazing.
Kind of.
Well, we'll get to that.
Yeah, that's coming up in the near future. But yeah, so this weekend was the TSCEC race at Cycleland. So we had the banquet from the 2010 series this Saturday night, and we had our first race of the 2011 series on Sunday. So tell me about your banquet and your race experience, buddy.
Well, my banquet experience, since I took the 2010 year off, meant that since I needed to attention whore for a little while, I went up and accepted someone that was not in attendance as trophy.
I'm a double A! I'm a double A!
I'm really awesome, I swear.
I promise you, I'm your brother.
Let me touch your trophy. No, but a friend of ours wasn't able to make it, and like I said, I was going to touch a trophy that night, and that's the only way that I could do it.
He wouldn't touch mine, but he'd touch somebody else who wasn't even there.
Yeah.
It's horrible.
We also had it was a good scene, getting to see a lot of people that I hadn't seen in a while, obviously with me being out of it for a bit. But everyone getting together for the first race of the year, there was that big vibe based around that. That brought a lot to the table. It was also nice to get together for a big meal the night before a race, and good and bad that it was BYOB. Some of us took a little bit more advantage of that than we should have.
Yeah, the two coolers full of beer.
Yeah, we weren't very popular.
We got so many looks for that.
Yeah.
Horrible. What? We're just having a good time.
Yeah, we were taking the largest coolers on the shuttle system.
Not just the largest coolers. We had two of the largest coolers.
Yeah, there were some comments. There were some smiles, though. So yeah. I think everybody else decided it was time to step up their game. They were bringing their game face when it came to drinking. But
really?
Pretty
sure we brought all the game faces.
Well, I know, but they...
they're all just taking numbers at this point.
Yeah, we had the liver destruction table. But we went ahead and moving on to the next day. Well, actually, let's hear about your banquet experience, because you actually had something that had to do with you.
Yeah, so we were at the banquet on Saturday night, which I really appreciate, you know, all the Vita Brevis guys showing up, all my Rogue Posse buddies, because I picked up all my stuff for, you know, for moving up to the AA class. I was asked which row I wanted to get. We had a small choice, and I went with 23A. I love 13. You know, there's no bad luck. It's all the luck you make for yourself. So I went with 23A. I got my nice little fanny pack with my name embroidered on it. It's got my little row on it. It's cute. You know, that's cuddly. Got some numbers. So I've got some professionally done numbers to put on my bike.
They're
Once I find money, once I find money to buy another number plate, because I'm not putting that over my 113 because I like it too much. But no, it was a lot of fun. Everybody was really supportive. Wes Knight did a great job. Yeah. He's the president of TSCEC. And so, you know, we've always been in a little bit more of a highbrow kind of place at the Texas Motor Speedway. And not to say where we were at was lowbrow, but just that it was just a different scene. It was a little bit more, it was definitely more low key, a little bit more fun. BYOB, just kind of.
There was such a laid-back vibe to it. It was awesome. Hard not to enjoy it.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun.
It was much more conducive to just having conversations with the table next to you. Everyone just kind of hanging out. It was a good scene.
Yeah, so it was a lot of fun. And it was just really great, too, to be able to pick up all of my awards and all of my... All of my accoutrements, if you will. With all my friends there and just yelling and hooting and hollering, you know, and just kind of making fun of everybody. So it was awesome. I really appreciate the banquet. Going on to the race situation, I think we'll go ahead and get the bad news out of the way first.
Well, this was my much-heralded return to racing, and unfortunately somewhat short-lived.
You're like, I want to do awesome.
I was like, maybe I'm going to be super kick-ass. So it came out, felt strong, body felt great.
You looked strong.
I was ripped. I bowed up. Doctor gave me lots of steroids to get ready for the weekend. Actually, she did. But came out, like I said, I felt strong. The bike felt strong. Went through the first section, felt good. Made it into the second section. And that's the first test there in the second section. Things started to go a little bit different for me. I felt good because I was hanging with people that are in a class above me. Problem being that I reached this point where I started to hear a noise. And...
It wasn't your own, like your brain working?
No. That's
absolutely
something.
Not.
Yeah, well, no. I mean, number one, that would scare me too.
That worked.
Yeah, that would scare me too. No, I started to hear a clatter, but as I've mentioned to many friends before, I was born with something that I like to term the competitive dickhead gene. And that
it's
caused
very,
me.
Very true.
Yeah, which is somewhat frustrating because I was also born with a total lack of skill gene. So those two things are always at odds.
Unfortunately, still true.
yeah, exactly. They kind of battle it out. And unfortunately, the competitive one is the one that makes me more of an ass.
I put up with you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Now, the clatter got a little bit worse, but I kept telling myself, you know what? I'm almost at the end of this test section. I'm just going to fight through it, get there, let the bike cool off, take a gander. Everything is going to be great. Wasn't as close as I thought. Ended up trying to pass a guy in a turn. I was telling myself I was going to baby the bike a little bit because I thought, well, you know, I caught this guy babying the bike. So I'll just pass him here and I'll be able to continue on my merry way, just taking it easy.
Babying.
Yeah, further babying. Yeah, well, I got into that corner and that competitive side that I was talking about, I just had to get all like rip into it and everything. Started to lose power, pulled off to the side of the trail, and my bike died from death.
Died from siege death.
Yeah, the piston seized just about threw my leg out of joint trying to kick it after the piston seized. If my bike was a cartoon character, it would have two X's over its eyes right now. So I'm going to have a big rebuild in my future trying to get ready for the next race in 2 weeks. The entertaining side for, I'm sure, some of the people that ended up on later rows than me was me thinking that the end to that test section was a lot closer than it was, so I thought I was going to run with my bike so I could get more
points. I'm Kurt Caselli!
I tried to channel. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah, that's not a bad thing. That guy's awesome.
Yeah, I figured I could pull upon his awesome to try to run with my bike to make it a little bit farther to get a little bit more salvageable points.
Don't ever try to pull on my awesome.
We should have a signal for that.
Yeah.
No, but they, it didn't work out.
Signal for that.
I love it when...
I love it when Jordan talks.
Yeah, that's what I was getting at.
You know it's serious.
Yeah. No, so my race ended not under the power of my own motorcycle. My race ended with my bike being pulled with a two toe straps together behind a big red Honda four-wheeler.
That's okay. You've joined forces with myself.
Yeah. I've actually sat at the rig and watched Brian be pulled in at Cycleland behind a four-wheeler.
Many a four-wheeler.
Yeah. So it was one of those things. At least I was in good company. But you had a much better go-around than I did.
I did, actually. Yeah. So it was my first AA race, 23A. And I had a blast, man. There was a couple guys I didn't know because none of my friends actually had the balls to ride on my row with me. They didn't want to be around a bunch of, you know, fast guys, whatever. But everybody that was on my row was really cool. It was tons of fun. And, man, I just went into the sections and tried to ride smart. I didn't want to put the bike down. Wanted to ride as fast as I could, carry momentum into turns, blah, blah, you know, the be smart about it, blah, blah, blah. And it worked. It was a lot of fun. Okay. It was awesome. I mean, I rode so good. The last two sections for me, I was getting tired. I was making dumb mistakes. I went down once in both sections. Both of them were dumb get-offs. But, I mean, in the second section, I rode the best I've ever read. Say for it. It's the best I've ever ridden in my entire life. I mean... I seriously can't say that I've ever like carried those speeds into those into turns like I was doing there. It was pretty cool, and I was only a couple seconds off most of the paces in that section, so I was really happy with that. You know, in the long run, my goal was to be within 10 minutes of the overall winner, and I was actually within 9 minutes of the overall winner. It may sound goofy to some people out there that doesn't know what's going on in enduros, but since your time accumulates throughout every section, you know, 30 seconds here and 20 seconds here, by the end of the day, can really turn into, you know, minutes on end. So for me, I mean, with being within 9 minutes of Hayden Franklin, who was the overall winner, I am very proud of that result, you know. Like I said, I made a couple mistakes in the things I need to work on, but I had a lot of fun. I had a lot of fun. The rain was awesome. The terrain was great. Cycleland did an amazing job getting everything together. It was a great weekend.
Yeah.
So
I had a good time. It's definitely not the way I would have wanted things to work out personally, but the event was put on well. Everybody there was great.
Yeah. If you have anything to learn from your bad luck and from my bad luck there, good luck is somewhere around the end.
Yeah.
It may not be next year. It may not be the year after that. But somewhere, you're actually going to finish that race.
See, the thing is, my first go-round at Cycleland, I finished the race.
Oh,
and
so
I think
I
set myself up for failure
this year
by doing well initially.
Yeah, but the guys who didn't set themselves up for failure were the ones that actually won this whole deal. Mm. Cycleland, Hayden Franklin, you ruled it, man. From what we heard, you had a great day, and the results showed it. You came down with a 51.05 was the score for Hayden. Don Hogan, who was in second, he came with a score of 52.35, and Caleb Ramsey came out with a 53.15. It actually looked like Caleb Ramsey was going to walk away with it, but he had a really bad second test section. He may have been out playing with the leaves. He may have been trying to find a tree. We don't really know, but hey, that's part of racing, man, and that's why enduros are so different. You know, every section is every section. You know, it's a new race every time. So
it's such a cumulative thing that by the end of it, if you have that one that you blow out, even if you've smoked it in every other section, it's going to come back to bite
you. Blow out and smoking it. On the TSCEC schedule coming up actually in 2 weeks is going to be the next race in Gilmer, Texas, and it's going to be at Barnwell Mountain. So if you guys, man, if you don't have anything going on or you haven't heard about enduros, you want to figure out what this whole scene is, it's another restart format, so you don't have to worry about timekeeping or any of that goofy stuff. I mean, I've got the computer for it. You can come talk to me about it. We'll work it out. I've got a book. You can buy it. That's fine. But we would love it if you guys came out, man. It'd be a ton of fun. You know, I'm really having a lot of fun talking to all the people at Toro and hanging out and goofing off. And to see those faces at TSEC races continuously, I think would be awesome.
Yeah.
So you all, please, you know, don't ever feel like you're not welcome in an enduro because you don't know anything about timekeeping. Because these days, We got enough restarts.
So few enduro races are actual timekeepers anymore. Restarts are a very simple format, and so it's a lot easier for somebody to come from the cross country scene to come from. One of our buddies had never ridden an enduro before. He's a motocross guy. He came out. He finished the long course. Had a great time. So it's something that I know a lot of people are intimidated by the thought of keeping time. It's just about a non-factor now.
Yeah. Nowadays, you just get to twist the throttle until they tell you to stop, so it works out.
Pretty much. You'll start, they'll check, they'll write on your fender, and then they'll tell you to go. And then they'll tell you to go fast. So
Go faster.
It's not hard to work through. One thing that we need to go ahead and touch on is that once again this week, our beer drinking is being sponsored by the fine fellows at Vita Brevis Clothing Company.
We all love those guys.
Oh, yeah. It's the whole concept behind Vita Brevis is that it's Latin for life is short. They're very plugged into the local racing scene. You'll see the Narvi, which is the camper done up with the Vita Brevis logos. You'll
see where we stay at.
Yeah, you'll find me sleeping.
You may either hear us and or see us, but that's where we'll be.
Yeah, it's actually, I slept in the Narvi this weekend.
Say it looks a bad thing.
No, yeah, it looks great. Awesome thing. Amazing. No, local-based clothing company. They try to be as involved with the local racing scene as they can. Check them out. Look them up on Facebook. Like their site there. Go to their website, vitabrevisclothing.com. They have everything out right now, whether it's hats, t-shirts, hoodies, all of the above. We were at the banquet, all of us looked like.
We were VB'd out.
Yeah, we pretty much had stuff on from head to toe. I felt very...
Well, that's okay. They just awesome. Like, I think we mentioned it last episode, they came up with the new hoodies.
Yeah.
And we all wound up getting them, wore them to the banquet. We had our shirts on, man. It's a good stuff. It's all good quality clothing, and at the same time, it's a lot of fun to wear it. So.
Yeah, and it's one of those things that... the proprietor of the company, Jeremiah Scratch Stone, he's even gone so far as we've got a little team going. So you'll see us at the races. You'll see him at the races. Come up, talk to us, hang out, come over to the trailer. Yeah. He'll always have product with him, and he'll be more than happy to show it to you. And
he'll be more than happy to push Bloody off of his bed so that he can then get to his t-shirt stash.
Yeah, I only use a couple as a pillow. You'll get one of those special Drool Mark edition ones.
Yeah, those are extra.
Yeah.
Goes into our... Never mind.
Yeah.
All right. So after talking about TSCEC, we go into something that other people would call more important, which would be the Supercross this weekend in Oakland.
Ah, yes.
So what do you have to say about this? This here Oakland Supercross.
This here Oakland Supercross. Starting out with the track, there are the things that I'm obviously on record as loving, but I know.
No. Yeah.
I know.
Over and under. I'd love to see, because every time those Toyota trucks have been on that weird little pedestal, I'm like, ooh, it's an over and under. No, it's not. Ooh, it's an over. No, it's not. This round, it's totally over and under, man. They left the trucks off. They put dirt on it, and they made it a ramp. And I loved it because it reminded me of Rad. Yeah. Crew Jones.
Cereal Bowl.
Loved it.
Hell Track.
Yeah.
Can't go wrong.
Always a good time.
I almost wore my Rad Racing t-shirt tonight.
Almost.
Almost.
You wrapped it around as a little diaper, didn't you?
No, I wore it as a cape and ran around the house chasing the dog.
That's a better way to do it.
Yeah. No, we're both simple creatures. He loves the over and under, and I love the hip jump.
This is
definite,
true.
Moment is true. Of moto boner. Anytime there's a hip jump, and it was the way the hip jump was set up on this track, it actually allowed people to take a wider line across it, cut inside to out, really lay it over. So it was one of those things that I was grinning from ear to ear every time they were running into that section of the track.
And you could definitely tell, you know, having said what you just said, how it gave them a little bit more opportunity to jump out instead of having to cut tight. And you could tell more people were more comfortable with that, and they were definitely kind of styling it up a bit and laying it out. It was nice.
Yeah, there was definitely pancake in the Waffle House. Otherwise, with the course, the whoop section was massive. Oddly spaced. It was like a little Loch Ness monster reaching up, or some sort of sea creature, and grabbing 250s.
Yeah, of nasty. Yeah.
Yeah, I have never seen a pro level race with that many people just bouncing around all cattywampus across a set of whoops, but those things looked killer.
Yeah, and you could tell they're all uneven, like you were saying, they're all unevenly spaced. Excuse me, there were the distances between them were different. It was, so I mean, it's set up for you know, what turned into just a kind of crazy race with through those whoops. It was nice. It was fun.
The 250s, like I said, were getting eaten alive through there, except for Tickle, who just turned it into his own little rhythm section where he was just like double, triple, quad, just popping through them and
having too much fun. That was his problem.
Making it look hellaciously easy when you're watching all these other pros run through there and realizing that no, it's not. Yeah,
difficult.
Because it's picking their pocket and stealing their wallets as they're going through, hopping from side to side. Otherwise, the course, the other thing that came into factor with the track was the rain that rolled in.
Yeah, that rain turned that thing, what looked like a slick track
to begin with.
Very slick track.
People were washing out on that track before the rain hit. So, obviously that kind of went downhill. Hit for both the LCQs, then into the mains, and it obviously made things a little bit more dicey than they would have been to begin with.
I think one thing, too, is, like, with the rain, you know, with the track was deteriorating as the night went on, but when the rain came in, it kind of allowed ruts to settle in a little bit deeper. And so you could tell that there was a lot of guys out there, especially Ryan Villopoto in his main, where, you know, they're in the rut, and they dabbed that front brake just a hair bit too much. And what happens? That front end grabs the inside of the rut and tucks, and boom, on the ground.
Yeah.
And, I mean, we've unfortunately pulled that move way too many times. I think you've tried to claim way too many berms on your own beforehand. Mm-hmm. But, that was definitely the key of the night, was just to try to stay consistent, stay smart, and stay upright, you know. And the guys that did that, they walked away with wins, you know. Yeah.
Heat one, while staying in the lights, heat one, Tickle and Morris dicing at it. They were just going to town. That was awesome, watching the two of them go at it.
Did Tickle Morris, or did Morris Tickle?
Well, they both left with a smile. All right. Heat two really came down to Hansen, Tomac, and Roczen. It was nice seeing Tomac kind of come into the Supercross season with some consistency, whereas in the outdoors and everything, he was kind of all over the... He came out hotter than the hell, just came out real strong, but then faded out as time went on. So far, I mean, we're obviously not very far in, but he's been fairly consistent in placing well. I mean, staying in the top 10, staying in the good spots.
I was glad to see Tomac on top as well.
Yeah.
Or as a top. At the top?
Yeah. Where are second.
We? I was glad second to the see, top. I was just glad to see Tomac.
Yeah. Great to see you, cuz. The
guy's cute.
Gotta love you. LCQ was Marmot and Champion. Not a whole lot to it there, to be perfectly honest.
Hey, man, you guys made it to the main. You're way more awesome than we are.
Oh, yeah. Not a shot by any means. Yeah.
No, we suck.
The main, going back to the subject of Tomac, came out, had the whole shot, was running strong, but that slick terrain. That front wheel washout was the phrase of the day, unfortunately.
Yeah.
He washed the front end on that long open sweeper and dropped from first to fourth, and then it was off to the races for some of the other folks.
Yeah, I mean, that main was awesome to watch, though, too, because, like, Roczen, he had really good consistency, but unfortunately he went down in the same straightaway that Tomac went down a little bit later. It was kind of funny because Tomac had more of a rear wheel slide out, while Roczen had more of a front wheel slide out. But, I mean, it was pretty much the same scenario, just a little too much and the wrong place.
Yeah, there was one spot where Roczen came in and he looked like he was about to ball it up. And then you're thinking, okay, well, Hansen was right behind him. You're like, okay, he's going to blow around him. It's over. Hansen is bobbling at the exact same point. Well, the two of them having those back-to-back saves. Tickle's line through the whoops was just kind of what helped him pull ahead and save it and everything. He was just so strong through there when everyone else was bobbling. Even when the right side of the whoop line had that channel cut through it because everyone was favoring it so much, his consistency through there is one of the things that I think got him through to the win.
Yeah, no, I agree. One of the things that I would, a big disappointment, unfortunately, in this main was the fact that Cole Seeley, I don't think it was the first lap, I want to say it was the second lap, is that he had kind of gotten into a couple guys. He didn't have the greatest start and wound up landing on one of the tough blocks, and it broke off his brake lever.
Yeah.
So he said he tried to keep riding with it broken off, and it just wasn't happening with the terrain the way it was, and the rain coming down. It was just too slick. So it just sucks to see. I mean, we know that he had confidence coming in from his last win, and it just kind of sucks to see that completely deflated.
It would have been nice to have him in there, nice to have him in a better spot in the points, just so he could be a name that was making a charge, because that seems like a good guy, seems like a good kid, makes me feel 1,000 years old to put it that way. Yeah. But it would have been nice good to have another name.
A new privateer Honda team. Well, yeah. Not new, but you know, newer privateer Honda team, you know, with a win. Yeah, getting a win. Yeah.
So the lights finished out with Tickle in first, Hansen second, Tomac in third, and Roxon rounding out in the fourth, just off the podium. But we got to love him kind of getting settled in.
No, I agree. Yeah, and his confidence, consistency, just kind of finding that nice little figure eight, you know?
Yeah. So for the overall this year, you've got Hansen still holding first, Tickle in second, Morrison third, and Tomac is sitting in fourth.
I want Tomac to get in there.
I'd like him to move up as well. No shot against anybody else. In the 450s, the heats went on pretty smoothly. Practice wasn't going smooth for some of the big boys.
Yeah, it was Stewart going down. He went down in the first practice hard, second practice hard, didn't even ride to third practice. So people had no idea. Yeah. People had no idea how he was going to do when he came out for the heat race. So.
Yeah, he was in the first heat, came out, rode strong, just basically took off.
Yeah, he took off from the whole shot and just got the checkered. It was like, boom, bitch is done, 8 laps, what's up?
Yeah, it was like, I'll be over here. It's one of those things that, like you said, after seeing how rough the two practices went for him, you were kind of on edge, because even though he had walked out and pulled away so hard, you're like, God, he seemed like he was having a bad time with this course.
Yeah.
But just that experience, that strength, he pulled, he was gone.
Yeah. No, I mean, Stewart rode great, and he proved that he was there to win it. So.
Yeah. Kennard ended up pulling second with a strong ride, and then Millsaps pulling in third. That was nice to see.
Yeah, I mean, Millsaps has been pretty inconsistent, to be honest. I mean, he hasn't even really been on the radar. You know, he's been saying it's been all kinds of dietary issues and all kinds of supplement-type stuff. And, you know, I mean, that's this, there, that, whatever. You know, people say whatever they want to say. It is or it isn't. He has not been performing, but he did this past weekend, so it is good to see him back on the back up top. And Alessi did not perform.
Mm.
Period. I don't know. I'm gonna ahead say it now. I like KTM. I've been riding a KTM now for about a year and a half, and I like the bike, you know. And I want a 350. I think the 350 should be doing better.
Mm-hmm.
And I just don't think that Alessi's putting in the effort. I don't know. It's hard to say because I'm not his dad. So, you know, I can't boss him around. But I really just don't know what's going on, to be honest. So, Alessi is a better rider than his performance has been showing. So, if something's going on, you know, maybe he needs to talk to Millsaps and his PR department to figure it out. I don't know. But something needs to happen.
It's one of those things where Alessi is always, it's not like he's just Mr. Outdoor. He's always been a force. He hasn't been top of the heat, but he has always done well in the Supercross. So for all of a sudden this year, him to drop off. Heat 2, the big part of that for me was that Reed came in strong. And that's something that I'd wanted to see all season. Him bringing up his own team, having to run that whole organization, not even a factory team. I've wanted him to do well. I like the guy. I'm a fan. I'm going to get some giant diamond earrings and rock him out.
You probably should. I want to get some of that shift gear.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
He's been... That's a good gear, man.
Good-looking
gear.
Nice, clean lines. That yellow scene was working pretty nice.
I was glad to see a different colorway, you know?
Yes.
The red on white looks good, but that green on yellow looks really good too. I don't know; they're just doing a good job with it. So
yeah, it was nice to see him make a podium in the second heat. It was Brayton first, Reed came in second, and Villapoto coming in strong in third. The LCQ, when you have a big name like Alessi in the LCQ,
you expect think he's to have gonna... big results.
Not so much.
Yeah.
And we're trying not to sound like we're tap dancing on Alessi's balls here, but it's kind of hard not to.
I mean, expectations, when they're not met, you know, people notice that sort of thing.
Yeah, that whole not delivering. That ended up being Blows and then Reardon taking the spots for the LCQ.
Yeah, no, I was happy to see that because Reardon just came back from a little bit of an injury, you know, with a new team that just came in from Australia, the JDR team. So I was happy to see not only Reardon back, I mean, you wouldn't expect him to just come blowing out there without, you know, going crazy or anything like that. But his pass on Alessi was awesome. I mean, Alessi just pulled over and gave it to him. So, I mean,
He gave it up like prom night. Yeah. There's no getting around.
Unless he may have something going on and he hasn't talked about it, but yeah. I don't know. That's fine. Everybody has their moments. Last weekend, I was an old man. My knees sucked balls, but
yeah. It's one of those things I'm really inclined to believe that there's something going on because even with, I mean,
he's been too quiet. Like,
he's been really quiet. The Alessi family obviously brings a lot of attention to
not
itself.
Not known to being quiet?
Yeah. So that side of things, I could imagine that there's something up. And it's not like the KTM team is without strong leadership right now. Yeah. So there's something going on there.
Yeah. Well, we'll see.
Yeah. Wait and see.
So, on to the main. Do it.
All right. Well, the main, Stewart, Villopoto, all the big names in there. The one thing I want to get out there real quick, and I'm not trying to speed bag anyone's scrotum at this point.
But we could.
But Stroop looked out of control.
Yeah, and I know he came out second, right, from the gate?
Yeah, second. He had a great start, but it was like had total panic eyes.
Yeah.
Unable to hold a lot. There are so many times that I think that the soles of his boots developed an allergy to his pegs. He was floating off the side. I'm not trying to I'm not saying when you lift up, you're trying to clear that extra little bit of gap and get that little bit of feel on the jump. I mean that he was blowing himself off the bike. Excuse me. One of those things that obviously tons of respect for the guy. He's fast as hell and has all kinds of talent, but he was scaring me.
Yeah, no, yeah. Stroop was definitely all over the place, though. But, I mean, like, while he was following Villopoto, and then Villopoto goes down, it was kind of interesting, man. The rain was definitely...
It was like another whole factor in it.
Yeah, it was the 21st... It was definitely the 21st rider, so... Yeah. It was a good run, though. Stewart, once Villopoto went down and Stewart passed him, man, it was Stewart's race. Like, Stewart could have lost that race, mm-hmm. but he didn't. He won it.
No, he pulled away like a train off of everybody else, and then it really came down to just seeing how everyone behind, seeing Kennard trying to work his way up from bad spot. Dungy rolling in second for the majority after the Villopoto drop.
Yeah.
Reed behind him, and then Reed just coming up at the last moment. And I love Dungy. Don't take it the wrong way.
Yeah.
But Reed coming up and picking his pocket.
Yeah, he just
on that finish line
snuck in, stole it. The commentators didn't know it, so it was done.
Yeah.
That was it.
It was one of those things that I was like yelling at the TV because I thought they were so busy showing Stewart taking the win, which, I mean, props to him. He just won the Supercross. He pulled away and left everybody else like they were tied to a tree. So obviously, yeah, show the guy taking his win. But when they're like, yeah, and Reed in second, I was like, what the hell?
Yeah, I don't
know. What didn't you show me 5 minutes ago? Did I stop? Go get something out of the fridge? I was like,
playing
it
with
threw
dinner.
Me.
I don't know.
Playing with shit. It happens. No, ended up, obviously, Stewart taking first. Reed coming in, picking Dungy's pocket for second. Dungy rolling in third. And then Villopoto making it back up and fourth after washing out before. Metcalf pulling in fifth. And Kennard coming all the way up to sixth, which, I mean, obviously don't usually run through that far in giving the scores. But
it's just good to know where
he worked up. Yeah, the way he worked up from such a bad spot to begin with. For the overall, that takes us Stewart's back in first. Villopoto's moved to second. Dungy's in third. Kennard's in fourth. And Reed is in fifth, which we still have all the big names all within striking distance of each other. So it's making it for a very interesting year. And I really hope it continues. I hope no one gets that big lead where they're up 50 points on everyone else and they start to walk.
Or no one gets a big crash.
Yeah. Everybody stays healthy. Everybody stays up in that top five. That way we can have an exciting year.
I agree. Speaking of exciting years, we've got another exciting Toro race coming up this next weekend here. It's going to be at Antelope Hills, which is in Jacksboro, Texas. The Ishmaels are actually putting this race on. I was talking to Cameron after we did our little interview last week. He said that his father has found some new terrain that he's going to put into the property, so it's going to be a little interesting. It's definitely going to be more technical, the most technical it has ever been. So, and it's probably going to be one of the most technical Toro races to date, which I am very excited for.
That's saying something.
I know, no, it's going to be awesome. The recon, they did this past weekend, so it should be up this week. And it's not up as we're doing this right now, but it will be. So we're going to go ahead and put that link into our show notes. so that you guys can watch the recon and go ahead and get yourself prepared for the awesomeness.
Back to the subject of Supercross real quick. Next weekend, they'll be back in Anaheim, and we'll be rolling into February, so it will be Breast Cancer Awareness Month.
Boobies!
Gotta love some boobies. So expect everyone to have on pink gear. We're recording this. It's actually still January, but...
That's why we're not topless.
Yeah, but expect great things for the month of February, as we will...
Definitely make sure that we celebrate the Tata month.
Yes, we will, and we will figure out a way to incorporate breast cancer awareness.
As family friendly as possible.
And we'll see how well that works.
It's but not.
We will love it when Jordan speaks.
I like your mouth.
I like the way you think, sir. Yeah. No, it might not be as much breast cancer awareness, but there will be breast awareness of some sort.
I'm going to be aware of somebody's breast. That's what's going on.
I usually try to be. Yeah. It's how I've lived my life to date. Figure why change.
Speaking of dates, as well coming up this weekend is going to be the round 5 of the OMA Winter Nationals. It's actually going to be in Nashville, Tennessee at the Nashville Super Speedway. They've got the ATV stuff going on Saturday, and then the dirt bike stuff going on Sunday. Bikes. The dirt bikes, not the motorbikes, it's the dirt bikes. That is happening this weekend, so we'll see. I don't know if Russell Bobbitt's going to be there. I haven't seen any updates on his Twitter account or any of that business, but if he is, we'll see if he can pull off another win. It'll be pretty awesome.
Another thing coming up in the pipeline is on March 5th, the Off-Road Cup is going to happen at DeSoto Motorsport Park in Shreveport, Louisiana. Sorry, I got a little tongue twisted there.
Beer twisted.
Yeah. Bottle flu happens to the best of us. The thing to look out for is it's coming up soon. It's on March 5th. The deadline for signing up is... Could you do one of those for me there, Hot Rod?
Oh, Jesus.
The deadline for signing up is February 18th. So that means that you've got to get on the ball. That's not going to be very far from the time this airs. It's a... Thank you. You're a gentleman and a scholar.
And I'm smart.
Let's not get crazy.
Okay.
No, February 18th is the deadline for signups. It's having an event like this close to the North Texas area. Yeah.
We've got to go represent, people.
Yeah. Everybody.
We're awesome. We're winners.
Yeah. Think about it. There are so many fast riders in Texas and the North Texas area even that having an event like this close, we need to have some representation at... People in Louisiana are obviously going to flow out there. Oklahoma, Arkansas, there are people coming from all around. So it'd be great to see some representation from some of our local cross country, enduro riders, all of the above.
So, local awesome people?
Yeah. Go out there and be awesome.
Yeah, that's all we're asking, all. Man. Take a shot of awesome. I don't care. Maybe a pintful. It's all a good time. And then taking it back a little bit, in all seriousness, our prayers from Seat Time, myself, Brian Pierce, Jason Schmidt, Jordan Hesse, all of our prayers go out to Amanda Woods and her two boys. This is definitely a tragedy that has happened, but we cannot go past the fact of what Nathan Woods would have wanted to have happen, and that is everybody continuing to have fun on motorcycles, racing, riding, you know, growing your family, however it comes down. The biggest thing we can do from this is learn and move forward. So we're going to miss him. He was a great rider, great ambassador to the sport. So it's really a tragedy, but we're going to move forward and we're going to say, you guys, we'll be here for you. If you guys need any help to Amanda, please let us know. We're going to do our best to help you guys out if we can find a way to do it for you. After that, man, we really appreciate you guys being here. It's been a lot of fun. And as well, I know that we have enjoyed a pint full of awesome. And you guys do as well. Thank you very much for paying attention. Peace, kids.
Have a good night.
Jordan's getting ornery. Watch out.
The fog, dude. It won't let me select a different track. It's like we're just going to do this track.
Show note, 1 minute 58 seconds.
Why?
technology owns Jordan.
Oh, fuck you.
What now, bitches?